expert with victim advocates as expert witnesses in trials, and there are not many victim advocates who have testified, and we would like to expand that pool. And so we are starting today with training. So I'm going to turn the time over to Marlise.
Well, so good to be here, and it's such a beautiful day today. Like yesterday, we all battled weather getting here, but then today, waking up to the blue skies against the red rock, it was just stunning. So my name's Marlise Jones. I'm with Utah Prosecution Counsel. Just to give you a little bit of background, I started 30 years ago as a 911 dispatcher, did that for a few years. Then I was paralegal support at the Davis County Attorney's Office till the early 90s, and then I became a victim advocate. And I did that for about 13 years, running the program in Layton before going back to law school. And then I prosecuted for just over 7 years before taking this job, which gave me a chance to combine all my different experience together and be out and work with law enforcement, which was always my first love, probably because of being a dispatcher, you just get really attached to the vulnerabilities and the needs that they have and the risks that they take on every single day. So I get to go out and train with them and advocates and prosecutors, and it's just been a lot of fun. I've just hit my 5-year mark of doing this, and I've just loved every minute of it. So one of the things that has brought this conversation on is, how many of you work in city prosecutor offices? Okay, so just a handful. How many are in county offices? Okay, some of you are in overlap of both. Do we have service providers of other community-based programs? Okay, what about medical-associated programs? So I'm missing a chunk. Who else is here?
Law enforcement.
Law enforcement, yay, hallelujah, glad you're here, okay. What else? Another group that maybe I haven't hit? CJC, awesome. Okay, so one of the things that I experienced as a prosecutor, and even as an advocate, because I was the only advocate in our city in Layton, but is most misdemeanor cases, I will say, whether it's in city or county, but particularly in city and towns, there's no budget for experts. And yet we all know, in working on domestic violence cases and sexual assault cases and other cases involving trauma, that the dynamics involved and the behaviors are really counterintuitive, right? You know, logically you think if you get hit, you would be done with the relationship and want to do everything you could to get justice, but that's just not the reality because of the many dynamics at play. And so we go to trial on cases and, you know, for the most part, you know, we were very careful as to what we chose to go to trial to make sure that we had a likelihood of success. But we could have expanded that much further if we had the resource of having someone be able to be an expert and explain the why. So the why behind these cases of DV and sex assault is not part of our elements. As prosecutors, we just have to prove the elements. But if we don't answer the why of our jurors or judges, if they're the finders of fact, they're not going to have those answers in their own mind, and they're going to likely take a not guilty stance with the defendants. So that role is really critical. And there's really no one better qualified as far as day-to-day foundational work than those that are in the field of advocacy. And so we're going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about some of the rules behind it. You don't need to worry about that in detail. That's what we worry about as prosecutors. But the reason I'm going to talk about it is I want you to have a sense of, I belong here. I can do this. I am that person that can do this. And then the prosecutor will, you know, will do notice. We'll walk through that when we use you as an expert. So let's get started with that. So what is an expert? We have a rule, of course, we have rules for everything. Interestingly, in practical life, as an advocate, you know, I'd sit in trials, and I was an advocate for, you know, many, many years. I'd sit in trials and think, why don't they say this? And why don't they say that? And then when I went to law school, I was like, oh, there's that thing called, you know, rules of evidence and Utah rules of criminal procedure. And there's all these bars and or limitations to timing as to when we can say what we want to say, or if we can even say it. So rule 702, this is where it talks about witnesses, and it is inclusive of anyone who has knowledge, skill, experience, training, or education. Okay, knowledge, skill, experience, training, or education, which includes everyone in this room, right? We all have that or combination of that. And if we have that, then you can testify in the form of an opinion or otherwise if the expert's scientific, technical, or other specialized knowledge, which that's the category you fall into, specialized knowledge, will help the trier of fact, so that's the judge or the jury, help the trier of fact to understand the evidence or to determine a fact in issue. So the role of an expert is to educate. And we'll talk about that a little bit more as we go along. But can you see how you as advocates fit solidly in that role? Now, how many here would like to be an expert? Take on that. Raise your hand, be proud. How many of you are scared to do it? Raise your hand. Okay, this is where we get the, you know, we can all do the wave at this point, right? So it's not as scary as it seems. It's scary because it's unknown, which is why we wanted to do this and do it in a format that is very discussion-based and flexible. Okay, so what we have to show is just a threshold showing. So here's the rule as to who can be an expert, but the bar to get to that level is this. It's a threshold showing, okay? So what it says is, if there's a threshold showing that the principles or methods that are underlying in the testimony, so what you're gonna talk about is reliable, is based on sufficient facts or data, and have been reliably applied to the facts. So it has to be relevant, right? I can't put you on the stand and have you talk about automotive if we're actually doing DD, unless somehow that's related. So it has to be relevant to the facts of the case. Threshold, when you look at that by definition, it's just a basic foundational showing of indicia. Indicia is one of those legal words, so I put in brackets, which is just a basic showing of indicators or signs of reliability for the testimony to be admissible. So it's a very low, it's a threshold. It's, you know, like the threshold of a door. It's a very low. We just have to show that, yeah, you know something that most other people don't know, or that a lot of other people don't know. That's basically when the rubber hits the road, that's what we have to show the court, is that you have experience, knowledge, training, education, and so forth, and you have a knowledge base that most people don't know and don't understand. Now, you guys all know from working in your caseloads and living in your own families and neighborhoods, that most people don't understand domestic violence, right? They don't understand sexual assault. So for us to get to that threshold to use you as experts isn't a tall leap by any stretch of the imagination. We're continually trying to educate and to get people to understand. And they still fight with what they've been hardwired, you know, growing up, or culturally what they've been hardwired with. So you've got the training, knowledge, specialized experience, and you certainly have it beyond a threshold. And so it's up to us to bring that out and to show that to the court. And generally, especially again in misdemeanor cases, you could be an expert in misdemeanor and or felony cases. There's no bar because you still meet that rule. But we typically will see that misdemeanor cases, there will be less of a fight, and fight is a strong word. There will be less opposition to you being an expert than there may be in a rape case or attempted homicide or homicide case. Okay, so we're gonna watch a video here. This is an example of an expert. How many of you have seen this video or this movie, My Cousin Vinny? Okay, it's hilarious. But Maddie's gonna bring that up for us. We'll watch it and then we'll talk about it after we watch this clip.
What you do in your father's garage?
Tune-ups, oil changes, brake relining, engine rebuilds, rebuild some trannies, rear ends.
Okay. But does being an ex-mechanic necessarily qualify you as being an expert on tire marks?
No. Thank you. Goodbye.
Sit down and stay there until you're told to leave.
Your Honor. Ms. Vito's expertise is in general automotive knowledge. It is in this area that her testimony will be applicable. Now, if Mr. Trotter wishes to voir dire a witness as to the extent of her expertise in this area, I'm sure he's gonna be more than satisfied.
Okay.
All right. Now, Ms. Vito, being an expert on general...
Can you guys hear that in the back?
No.
Can you tell me...
Can you read it?
What would the correct ignition timing be on a 1955 Bel Air Chevrolet with a 327 cubic inch engine and a four-barrel carburetor?
It's a bullshit question.
Does that mean that you can't answer it?
It's a bullshit question. It's impossible to answer.
Impossible because you don't know the answer.
Nobody could answer that question.
Your Honor, I move to disqualify Ms. Vito as an expert witness.
Can you answer the question?
No, it is a trick question.
Why is it a trick question?
Watch this.
Because Chevy didn't make a 327 in 55. The 327 didn't come out till 62. And it wasn't offered in the Bel Air with a four-barrel carb till 64. However, in 1964, the correct ignition timing would be 4 degrees before top dead center.
Well, she's acceptable, Your Honor.
Okay, sorry we didn't have the volume for you to hear it. The link is there. You know, you're welcome to go back, obviously, and watch it. But the long and the short is he wants to put her on as an expert. The opposition by the defense attorney is he doesn't want her to be an expert. So then he asks a question, which, of course, as she says, is a bullshit question. And they go through that, and then she explains why. And, of course, it's dazzling. Generally, what we're testifying to is not technical, right? So I don't want that. As I was watching that, I'm like, okay, we're testifying to different things. We're testifying to soft facts, to philosophical, theoretical, behavioral facts. So don't let that be intimidating to you. However, she knew from working in her dad's garage, all she needed to know to be someone with experience in education and training beyond the threshold. Right? So if she could be an expert, we can be an expert. And it's just, it's a good, funny video about that. So if we can go back to PowerPoint when you have a second, Abby. So one of the things, and there's another clip, if you go on YouTube to look at it, there's another clip where she actually is testifying to tire marks, and she goes into explaining the tire marks, which is another good example of how we should be interacting with the fact finder, in this case, it's the jury, where we want to be teaching, and we'll touch on that again. So who can be an expert? Da-da-da. Okay, you guys can be experts, right? We've got that threshold, but we have other people that can be experts as well. And this has more value, I guess, applicable, although you could be supportive in this, because how many of you are maybe the one or only person in your agency and or in your area? And I'm sure there's some online that fit in that. So we'll talk about best case scenario as far as being experts, but sometimes you're not going to be able to be the expert because of the limited resources that your area has, but you can help keep in mind other people. So for example, officers, they can be an expert. I had an attorney call me, it's been a couple of years now, but he called me and he says, you know, I've got a domestic violence trial and I wonder if I need an expert, can I run it by you? And honestly, he didn't have to run the scenario by me. I could have said, yes, you need an expert. My personal feeling is anytime you're dealing with domestic violence, there's a why that has to be answered. And so, yeah, we want to use an expert. So he runs it by me and I said, yep, absolutely. You know, you need to have an expert. And he says, well, how do I do that? My trial's tomorrow. And I was like, okay, well, who are your officers? And he had two officers coming and one of them had a lot of years of experience. And I said, you know, how well do you know him? Have you talked to him before? Do you feel like he's, you know, victim trauma informed? Do you think he could testify? And he said, yeah, absolutely. So then you can use him as your expert for trial. He already knows the case. He already knows the facts. And to get out the things that he needed in his case facts, that was going to suffice. That won't always be the case, but we have other options. So just keep that in mind. Shelter workers and caseworkers. If you're system-based and you're not able to because of your exposure to a case, draw on one of your community-based partners. We should absolutely be partnering with our both system and community-based agencies in every area that we live to create that strongest network for support for our survivors that we're working with. So shelter workers, psychologists, psychiatrists, there's a time and a place for this as well. We had a trial. It was actually a sex abuse trial that I was second chairing with another agency, and we needed an expert, and that agency had no budget for it. It was a class A, but they had no budget for it. And so I started asking around and calling around, and I found a local therapist who was an LCSW, who focused on teenagers, and we had a teenage victim. And talked to her at length. She also had some law enforcement in her family, so she wasn't, you know, new to the field, so to speak, and she agreed to be our expert witness. So there's that as an option as well. Paramedics, EMTs, you know, first response, again, depending on what the information is, they can be it. Doctors, nurses, firefighters, anyone with special knowledge. Question, Alex.
The question is, are we, in that case you just laid out with the therapist, who's in the neighborhood that's willing to do it. Is the point of that to decrease the expert fee or to not have it involved? That makes sense. Like, are we actually build a victim advocate community so we can go and do these things and like not get paid? Or are we asking to do this and go and it be a little bit more affordable for prosecutors because we're not flying in for New York?
We're trying to develop a pool that is willing to participate and support other cases that they're not involved in at no cost. That's where the barrier is. I keep an expert witness list, and I don't post it because it's always changing. I'm adding people and taking people off as their circumstances change. There are some people on that list that hands down, they won't do it if they don't get paid. But there are other people that understand the vision and the need, especially in these lower cases, misdemeanor cases. The majority of our DV cases are misdemeanors. Those typically do not have a budget for an expert, and we need experts. We know that domestic violence is the greatest contributor, single contributor to the homicides in our state. You know, close to 50% of our homicides are related to domestic violence. So we're wanting that. And the more we have, the less then someone will have to do all of it themselves, right? Because there is a time commitment involved in it. You're going to get lots of subpoenas, and the majority of them are not going to go to trial, and that's just the court process of us building up to going to trial. But the goal is to eliminate that. Now, if you are being consulted as an expert in a case that, you know, perhaps is getting more complex or at a felony level, and you feel that you can't do it without a time commitment that needs to have some financial remuneration, I'm not telling you can't do that. You can do that. You're not limited. Our goal and what we're trying to do is to develop an expert pool broad enough that it won't be taxing on any core group of people, and that they're able to do it at no cost. So we can actually use them. So we can actually, you know, explain the whys to our juries and to our judges. So good question. So why would we use an expert? What are some reasons you think an expert would be helpful?
Education. You're trying to convince a court or jury.
Yeah.
Convince, but educate.
Yeah, education.
To kind of figure and understand, like, maybe why a victim wouldn't want to testify themselves in certain leading cases.
Right. We have a lot of cases that could go to trial, and our victim isn't able to participate due to their own trauma and the dynamics. But we can explain that, as opposed to a jury or a judge thinking, well, if they really cared, they'd be here. So if it's no big deal to them, it's no big deal to me. We can explain that, which is a significant education piece. Any other thoughts on it? Okay, so we want to educate. We also want to educate on myths and biases, because our community is full of them. People do not understand. And it's not just the jury, but it's the public and the judges and anyone within earshot. One of the things that, you know, that I've said time and time again in prosecutor trainings is if you get an expert on, say, in a preliminary hearing, which may or may not be necessary, or at a trial, and you think it may or may not be necessary, we're educating that judge. And the benefit to us is that judge is looking at motions that we're making at a pretrial stage. And if we've educated that judge, they're more likely to rule in our favor on motions if they actually understand the dynamics and the obstacles to these kinds of cases. So we want to educate. Some of that includes dynamics of victim responses, educate to help follow the trauma. There's a lot of trauma evidence, especially in sexual assault cases, but it's also absolutely there in domestic violence cases, in armed robberies, home invasions, even terrible car accidents. So we can educate on why there's a response, you know, why someone who has had a crime committed against them is laughing. You know, instinctively, people are gonna be like, okay, well, this is a joke. But the reality is laughter is a very common, very typically applied response to trauma. And all of us have probably done it at one time in our life, regardless of the level of trauma. So we wanna also prepare for the defendant's cross-exam to lay the groundwork. So you can get on the stand, explain some of the dynamics. Then if the defendant is going to testify, and we frequently don't know, that is a choice they get to make right up to the last minute. It's not to say there aren't some circumstances where it's been very clear from the very beginning by how they're going to get on the stand and they're going to give their side of the story. But usually we don't know. So we're building that foundation, right? We're laying that groundwork. We're providing that education. And then if the defendant is going to testify, now we've laid that foundation so that the jury will hear that defendant's testimony through educated lenses. And then we can get up and cross-examine the defendant. Prepare for the cross-examination of the defendant's expert. Misdemeanor cases, most often they will not have their own expert, more so in felony cases, and then there'll be sort of the dueling of perspectives. Misdemeanor cases, most often they're just gonna try and poke holes into, you know, our expert testimony, but it could be the other way around. You also are a great benefit to helping us. How many here have had conversations with your prosecutors about a case where you felt like you've taught them, or at least tried to teach them, the reality of the dynamics in a case, right? Yeah, and you know that is invaluable to have. And so when they're looking at a case and they're maybe seeing it through this lens, and maybe they're all for going to trial, all for filing it, all for going in the right direction, but they're missing a couple of pieces that you can provide. So if you're participating as an expert, if your prosecutor knows that you have that desire, and if you are having those conversations with them, you can help them earlier on in the case to feel better about their footing in taking this case forward. Assist the prosecutor with trial strategy, sentencing recommendations. Those are all things that are beneficial. How many of you have ever testified in court? Not necessarily as an expert, just ever testified for any reason, you know, traffic ticket, whatever it was. Okay. What was your experience with that? Anyone want to share? Oh, we got a thumbs down. Two thumbs down. Josh?
As a prosecutor, I enjoyed it because I never get that opportunity. So I got to do it at the justice court level and then at a disciplinary, like our professional disciplinary community, which is similar to court.
Right. Were you nervous?
No.
No?
I wanted the guy to go down.
Yeah, you were there, you were ready. Okay, anyone here testified that was scared to do it? Okay, you're the typical, right? That's more normal. I can remember back years ago as paralegal support, we had an order to show cause. It was part of a drug diversion program. And so I had to testify. And I remember being, you know, very scared to do it. It was completely unknown. I'd never done that before. And it was just because it was unknown. Rochelle.
In the chat, Ellie says that the defense attorney can sometimes be pushy and ask the same question over and over again, trying to get a different answer.
Yes. Yeah, they can do that. Prosecutors, you know, there's a balance with objecting as prosecutors. We don't want to ever appear to the jury, the fact finder, like we're trying to hide information. But if they're asking the same question, we absolutely can object and say, you know, objection, Your Honor, it's been asked and answered, and encourage the court to move along. So we'll talk a little bit more about defense attorneys and being prepared for defense attorneys. Holly.
Well, I think it's odd is we normally want to tell the whole story. Just as people, we'd like to get up there understanding, give you a whole presentation about it. Instead, we're being asked a pointed question And it, to me, it's uncomfortable because I feel like I didn't tell the story, but I have to remember if I'm playing a piece of the puzzle as the expert witness who does a piece of it, and it is going to help you with the story, but that is, it's just an uncomfortable feeling, I feel like.
Right.
He can not be asked any questions, but.
Right. Just tell them how it is. Educate them, right? And that's not how it plays out in court. It is more, it will feel more incomplete based on what you're asked, your response, as opposed to feeling like you said everything you needed to say.
Yeah.
Michelle?
Just to repeat some of the questions for our online attendees, it cuts out for them.
Okay. Looks like someone else had a chance to testify at a protective order hearing and got to explain the lap. So that's a great experience to have, but the reality is it can be nerve-wracking. But after you do it once, it will be a whole different ball game the next time. And the more you do it, the more comfortable you'll be with it, because it's not hard. It's just new. It's just different. You just haven't done it before. Oh, you have to, of course, can't miss out on this little joke, you know. There's all kinds of these funny things that attorneys will ask in court, you know, and we're under a lot of pressure and invariably, you know, things will be asked and then the witness, of course, catches on that, you know, we're lacking some IQ. So that was my little snippet there. So keep in mind who you're educating. Know your audience. So think about the cultural neighborhood dynamics in the different areas of the state. What is your jury going to look like in Panguitch compared to what is your jury going to look like in downtown Salt Lake compared to what is your jury going to look like in Kaysville, right? They're going to look very different. There are communities have different makeups. They have different mindsets, different norms. There are some communities that are very rural, and in general, the jury feels like live and let live and don't put your nose in other people's business. So that's a different struggle for a prosecutor than other areas where that's just not the belief. People aren't living out in the middle of a rural setting and they are more involved in what they want their community to look like. Judge, jury, public, victim, defendant, family, all of this is educating. So if you're on the stand as an advocate and you're providing information about abuse and there are other people in that courtroom, you're also educating them. You never know the number of lives you could be touching and affecting by sharing the information about the dynamics and some of the counterintuitive things that individuals are engaged in when they're surviving domestic violence relationships and other traumatic relationships. So how do they help? You know, it's an issue that has to be addressed, misconceptions, biases that we have to address. I was talking to my mom, I talked to her just about every day. She's 81 and she made a comment about a rape case and how this young lady was dressed. And I said, but mom, that how the young lady is dressed is not an indicator of you know, her being raped. And mom said, well, you know, of course it is, you know, if they're dressed like that, then, you know, they're asking for it kind of a thing. And I said, okay, mom, let me put it to you this way. If there was a young lady dressed in a certain way, and I have a brother, Sean, and Sean was to come across her, would he rape her? And she goes, oh, of course not. That's ridiculous. And I said, well, why is that ridiculous? Well, he'd never do that. He's not a rapist. And I'm like, exactly. Has nothing to do with what she's wearing. It has to do with who the person is that is targeting and looking for that vulnerability. And she's like, I never thought of it that way, you know, because her age group, it was all about what they were wearing, right? And we're getting a little bit less away from that, but it's a slow ball to turn, right? But that's just an example. So we want to address those issues. We also can be helpful if the defense has an expert to actually educate, and you're going to say what you know. You're going to testify to the truth of what you know based on what you know. And then the attorneys are going to argue. You don't have to argue. You don't have to win it. You're just providing the information. We cannot argue things in our closing arguments if it hasn't been testified to or if evidence hasn't been provided. So I can't just, even though I know all things, well, not all things, but I know a lot of things about domestic violence, sex assault, and trauma. If I'm doing a trial, I can't, in closing arguments, just start bringing all that in. I have to have someone who's testified to that. And you're going to be my most valuable person to do that. Okay, so some examples. These are some things that you may consider possible game, depending on your case, of topics to talk about. Okay, so on scene demeanor, what a victim looked like. Some officers, when they respond on DV calls, the victim's very calm, very quiet. Other times they're hysterical and acting quote unquote crazy, right? We can explain that, we understand that. PTSD, what that looks like. The neurobiology of trauma, meaning what does trauma look like and how does that affect people's behaviors? And that trauma is every emotion. Financial impact, child-related concerns. I think these are probably two of the greatest barriers to our victims being able to feel like they can successfully leave a relationship. Second only, of course, to fear of death, right? But as far as practical life scenario barriers, these child issues and financial barriers and explaining that, you know, when I train law enforcement, I'll say, okay, when you go home tonight, you're gonna get a call that you just lost your job. Now, how many of you is that gonna impact your stress level? And of course, everyone raises their hand. Whether they're the sole breadwinner or they have joint incomes, if all of a sudden one income is gone, what impact is that going to have? And yet somehow we think that in a domestic violence relationship or the normal societal expectation is, well, she should just leave. Well, they should just leave, right? And we think, well, wait a second, what does that actually look like? There's a lot of obstacles there. And of course, child-related concerns. Our courts believe that a bad parent's better than no parent. And victims know that they can leave that abusive relationship, but are the kids gonna go back for parent time? 9 times out of 10, yes, they are. They're gonna go back for parent time. So they're gonna be in physical danger. And then of course we see the polarization, right? We see some kids that end up with having no relationship with the victim parent because the perpetrator parent has dominated and they feel safe being with the power parent, even though it's unsafe. It's like keeping your enemies closer to you kind of a thing. And they're kids, they're trying to survive. So we've got polarization of kids. How many of you want to go home and then decide which of your kids are going to give up starting tomorrow? Teenagers don't count. Right? Like, I mean, none of us want to give up a kid, right? We have moments. We have moments. But there's always good ones to offset it. So just recognizing and educating on that, the cycle of violence, what that can look like, the power and control wheel, you're all familiar with that, the power and control wheel, what that looks like. Lethality assessments, the lap, the value from that, medical and injuries. Do we always see injuries on domestic violence cases? No. Does that mean that there's not a risk of lethality? No. Right? On the lap, we have one of the questions is whether or not the other person is unemployed. Do we take people to jail for being unemployed? No. Is it a crime to be unemployed? No, but it's a risk factor for lethality in a domestic violence situation. So explaining some of those differences. What about when we have victims who aren't able to participate because of the dynamics, because of the trauma, or maybe they've come back in and said it was all their fault, it was all a misunderstanding, or it just flat didn't happen. Now the whole account has changed. Has anyone not had that experience? Yeah. Like, that is the norm, right? That is what we see. Well, a jury isn't gonna understand that. And a lot of judges don't understand that as well. We've had, every now and then we have sort of this surge changing of the guard on the bench. And so then we get new judges and we have to educate them. Some of them come from civil backgrounds. Some of them come from criminal backgrounds. Some are more defense oriented. Some are more prosecution oriented. But the realities of what they need to know is so invaluable if you can be part of that pool of experts to help educate them. Some cautions. You never want to testify in a way where you are drawing conclusions. You're providing information, you are not drawing conclusions. You are not going to testify in a case in a way that says that victim's telling the truth. You're gonna provide information, and the jury is going to draw their inferences and the prosecutor is going to draw on your testimony to make argument as to what those inferences could look like. But you're not going to draw those conclusions. To do so could result in a mistrial or on appeal if you get overturned. So you have to be careful and have those conversations. And I would tell you flat, ask your prosecutor, what should I not be saying in this case? There are certain things, and the reason why you ask that is there are things that we have stipulated to prior to trial that we will not get into at trial. Things that have been part of our discussion with the judge, pretrial motions that we cannot talk about. And you need to know what that is. You know, what can I not get into in this case? Generally, you also don't want to be an expert if you are aligned in some way with this. So if you're the therapist, the specific therapist of that case. There are some instances where that's appropriate, but generally for what we're talking about, we are seeking you as an expert on a case that you are not familiar with and you have not worked with that victim, because your knowledge base of general principles, general dynamics, general information, counterintuitive behaviors, that's the power of your expertise. That's the power of your testimony. So if you're in an area that has limited resources, again, that's where you're going to partner with. If you have more than one advocate, then a different advocate can do it. If you can draw on your community advocates, if you're system-based. I have never testified as an advocate in a case that was my case. And there were cases where it was very beneficial if I could have, but as we talked about it in the office, we never actually went down that road when I was an advocate because, number one, there was concern about betrayal, feelings of betrayal by the victim, and they are the number one priority, making sure that they feel like they have that support regardless. But then there's also the risk of being attacked by defense attorney that you're biased because you know this victim. Now, there are going to be some areas where you know everybody, right? And so it's going to be hard to testify. But again, your prosecutor is going to be aware of that. And you can talk about what you can say, what you can't say, and how narrow you're going to keep the focus. Josh.
That seems very specific because a victim advocate or coordinator is like intimately involved with that person. Do you have the same opinion about, like, and this is maybe a little bit different from what we're talking about, but like a CJC director who performed a forensic interview, but also is an expert in child testimony. Do you think that there's any problems with having that person as a hybrid back and an expert witness?
It's going to depend on the case, number one. But I would say if you have an option, I would tend to explore the other option. But if you don't, if they're who you have, then just set the, you know, the bumper, like in a bowling line, set the bumper up. This is what we're going to talk about. When you file notice with the court, when they file their report with the court as to what they're going to talk about, be very clear on this is what the focus of the testimony will be, and keep it in there. If defense opens the door, then that's a different discussion. And they may or may not do that, especially if they're trying to attack on bias. But just have encourage and educate. And so like Josh is a prosecutor, me as a prosecutor, I'm going to be educating my expert on what is the most important thing out of their testimony. There's going to be other things in your testimony that we want to get out just as context for the education we're offering, but there's going to be key pieces, key issues that are going to be the most important. And so just communication between them is going to be the best way to approach it. Up in Cache County, if you don't have someone else, you know, you actually have pretty good resources up there, but if you don't have someone else, then just set those boundaries and stick to them to protect from the bias. But also, can we argue against the bias? Like if you do know this victim and you're the expert on the stand and, you know, you're in a rural area or a circumstance where it's unavoidable and you're testifying, and the defense attorney asks you and says, isn't it true that you know John? Or isn't it true that you know Susie? And of course you're saying yes. Well, doesn't that make you biased? And then you can clearly explain and say, what I'm testifying to is what I have seen over hundreds of cases or 50 cases or whatever cases. So no, my testimony isn't based on Susie. My testimony is based on the research and the courses that I've taken and my understanding of working with multiple victims, right? So it's not a dead end street. It's not insurmountable the vast majority of the time. But if we can avoid it, we want to avoid it. We want to have less fights, you know, involved. And again, fight is probably not the best. We want to have less opposition or confusion for the jury as we can. Okay, so how many of you have testified as an expert? Raise your hand. And I won't make you share comments, but we have a couple. Any comments you want to share, lessons learned, or something unexpected that you experienced when you were on the stand? Danette?
I just want to mention back to that previous comment about testifying that you have worked with the victim. And when you're making the decision whether it's appropriate for you to do expert testimony, that you always need to take into account how your victim feels about that. Because many times you are kind of pushing the things and like, is it possible this person could lie? And if your victim's sitting there in the room and you say, yes, it's possible that she's lying, it can damage that. It's an advocate relationship. And so I think it's always good take into account how it affects your victim and if they're comfortable with you providing the information. In a case that you've been involved with, and for most agencies, you know, you have a supervisor or coworker that was uninvolved. But I think that's a hard thing is sometimes if you just ask yes or no questions and you have to say things not in a way that you wish you could say them. But doing expert witness testimony is what everybody in this room does all the time. And very much at the story of the mom, we're always advocating for victims. We're always educating our community. We're always trying to help explain things. And it's just that same scenario of helping people understand how complex and finally challenging is and helping them understand from your perspective.
Okay, so for those that may not have heard all of that online, Dennett made a really good comment about if you are going to have to testify on a case and you do know that victim, have a conversation with that victim. Find out their thoughts and feelings about it from them. Prepare them for the positives that could come from it. Educate them so that they're part of that team, part of that decision. If there's negative testimony that could come, so she gave an example of if they're asked if it's possible that this victim could lie, I'd be objecting, calls for speculation. But regardless of that example, if there is some negative information, the prosecutor already knows it or should know it, because if the advocate knows it, the prosecutor has to know it. And we're going to address that. And we're going to already talk to the victim about what that negative information means and how we're going to offset it or how we're going to argue against it or how it's just clearly not relevant, how it just doesn't matter. So if you are in a situation where you have to testify involving your victim, make sure they are part of that conversation and understand clearly why that's happening and the benefits of it happening. And then strongly consider if they're flat against it, like absolutely no way, I thought you were here for me. I mean, if it's gonna cause them more damage, then you need to step back and reassess. Is there someone else that can do it? Is there an officer that could do it, that could be the expert? Is there someone else that could be the expert to avoid that harm on that victim? Rochelle, did you want to say anything on that? You've testified a few times, more than a few probably.
No, other than as you know, I feel anxiety about a lot of things, but it is, you just have to keep in mind that the end goal, like it is intimidating, but you use the knowledge that you have. And sometimes it is interesting. So as an advocate, I think empowered to like talk to the prosecutors, make sure that you have really clear expectations, because that's like kind of been up there railroaded, thinking the prosecutor thought I was going to testify about one thing and that's not my expertise. I was asked about like offender behavior, and that's not who I've worked with. And so just to make sure that you are able to advocate for yourself about what you can testify and what you cannot testify to.
Okay, and we're going to touch on that. That is very, very important. Thank you, Rochelle. Okay, so some things that can help qualify someone as an expert. Again, we've talked about the experience. Some of you have degrees, some of you do not. Most of you have probably not written articles or books. Anyone here that has written an article or book on victim issues? Okay, so we have a couple, but most of you have not done that. And that doesn't mean that it's the end of the world. Alyssa has not done that, and she's an excellent expert testifier as an advocate. Trainings attended and or given. Okay, you have been to trainings, you zoom into trainings, you want to keep track, and you probably already have, counting for your own hours of training for NOVA certification, your state acknowledgments of your education. So you can have that information, and that will be part of your CV that we're going to talk about just briefly about doing curriculum vitaes, or what they are called. Basically, we have to give a resume to the defense attorney of what your background is, why you would be an expert, and you can list those on there. Cultural competence. How many of you serve areas where there is exceptional poverty, different cultural backgrounds, okay, different religious backgrounds? Okay, there's so many different areas, different languages, language barriers. We have people in court, and as a prosecutor, like I've had conversations with these defendants, and then we went to court and they asked for an interpreter, and I'm like, you don't need an interpreter, they know how to speak English. There are some people that come in and want an interpreter just because, but the reality is we're talking about their life, their criminal history, potentially their liberty. Should we make every effort to make sure that they understand every single word and aspect of what's happening in court? Absolutely. And so having people understand the cultural dynamics about why someone would not participate in a court case or would not call the police when they needed help. We work with people that are undocumented and they have huge barriers to seeking help because of that fear of being undocumented. And of course, most of the time their perpetrators threaten them with it as well. So this is an area that really has nothing to do with victim dynamics per se, specific domestic violence, but has everything to do with cultural dynamics. And that can be very important as far as our expert testimony. So the curriculum vitae, there's a couple just snapshot pictures here. Look, think of it as, like I said, a glorified resume, okay? So you're going to have your education and experience on there, like your resume, but you're also going to have additional experience and information on there, like the trainings you've been to, like articles or books that you have written, like classes that you have taken, you know, anything, your experience within a community, your understanding of dynamics within a community, you're gonna put all of that in. So it's not going to be 1 to 2 pages, it's probably going to be multiple pages. How long is yours, Rochelle?
Honestly, mine's actually very short, one page.
It's one page?
Yeah.
How about you, Jeanette?
Say again?
How long is your CV?
It's like 2 pages.
2 pages? Okay, and part of it is because you guys are young. I'm old. If I had a CV, it would be pretty lengthy. And then it just depends, you know, on your background and the diversity of things that you've done as well. Some people have been within a specific niche. I've been in a variety of niches, so mine looks different. And so there's no right and wrong, but there's a variety of things that could be and should be included in your CV. I thought you said you prepared him. So this is a two-way street. Our prosecutors need to be putting the time and effort into preparing you. You need to be grabbing them by the ears and going, hey, you need me on the stand. I need to know what's going on. You know, we need to talk. So it's a two-way street. Understand, of course, you know you're overworked as far as caseloads and victim needs, but our prosecutors also have tons of cases. They usually have multiple cases, especially misdemeanor courts set for trial on the same day. They don't know which case is going to go. So just make yourself very available and make it a priority to go, hey, remember me? Hey, is that case gonna go? Hey, we need to talk about that. I need to know what you need from me. Be very focused on talking with them and sharing that information, getting ideas about what the prosecutor is trying to explain or educate on, and what cannot be said. So like Rochelle said, you know, offender behaviors, if that's not your niche, do not come up with an answer to testify on that. If you get asked that, that's not your niche. That's not on your CV. It's not in anything that you've done in your life to a degree that you could pass that threshold. Just say, I'm sorry, I can't testify to that. That's not where my expertise is. That's the most professional, most credible response you can give is to say, I don't know all things. I only am really good at these things. And that's not something that I know. And I can't comment on that. Get questions from your prosecutor, exchange and identify best questions. Alyssa was always really good with this. And the more you testify, the more you can help newer prosecutors, because we're encouraging the new ones to do this just as much as the experienced ones. Newer prosecutors, like if they want this issue, then here's a good question to ask me that I can then provide that information. We all think differently, right? Have you ever had someone ask you a question you don't know what they're getting at, right? That's what we want to avoid while you're on the stand. If you have information and you need us to ask it in a certain way, then tell us. If you ask me this, then I'll know what you're trying to get at. I'll understand, we'll be on the same wavelength. You also want a chance, if necessary, and most of the time it won't be, but if there's some other visual aid or evidence that they want you to comment on, you want to have a chance to see it ahead of time, or at least have an understanding of, you know, I may tell you, I want to address the power control wheel. Are you familiar with that? Yes, okay, just make sure you're prepared on that because we'll be talking about it in your testimony. Some other tips, be calm. Don't lose your composure. Most attorneys are well-behaved in court, but not all. Ask your prosecutor about that as well. They know which behaviors, you know, are up to antics in court, or which attorneys can be more confrontational than others. There's an attorney that I went up against, I have greatest, you know, respect for him. And he led my officer down this lovely lane off a cliff, and the officer thanked him on his way down. Like, that's just how that attorney works. And then there's other attorneys that are just like totally into more confrontational styles. If we have a chance to see that, we can share that with you. So ask us about it. Don't get in an argument with them. They will get a chance after we ask you questions. They'll get a chance to ask you questions. Just clarify what you know. Know what you know, clarify it. Don't make stuff up. Not that you're trying to lie, but sometimes under pressure, we feel like we have to come up with an answer. If you don't have an answer, leave it at that. Excuse me. I already talked about this. Use eye contact with the jury. They're the ones that you're talking to. So you can talk to, if you're really nervous, you can talk to your juror, to your prosecutor. Sorry, wrong pipe. I need to breathe and swallow separately. Give me a second. So if you're really nervous, listen up, this is really important. I'm losing my voice now. If you're really nervous, it's okay to just talk to your prosecutor. But it is the jury that's deciding. And so you want to pay attention to them and to educate them. In that second clip that I didn't include with Marissa Tomei, she was talking about tire marks. And she gave an analogy with it about, you know, how when you're stuck in the mud and you're giving it gas and one tire's spinning and the other tire's doing nothing. That's what this means. And the jury was all, oh, yeah, okay, I know that. They could relate to it. So we want to provide that kind of teaching atmosphere with our jury. Speak English. Some people get on there, and this probably isn't going to fall to this group, but probably some of the most frustrating things as a prosecutor is when you get someone who is a doctor or someone who's got, you know, this academic background, and they just want to dazzle with their smarts. And it's like, not helpful, just speak English, right? Explain it in a way that makes sense to the jury and to the judge. So don't worry about, you know, dazzling with your academic knowledge. Worry about, how can I teach this in a way that makes sense to them? How can I describe this in a way that has meaning to them? Thank you. Body language is important. You don't want to act disinterested. You don't want to be hostile. It's easier for you to be engaged with the prosecutor, and it's easier for you to be resistant and defensive with cross-examination, and you don't want to be either, or you don't want to be differentiated that way. You want to be objective and professional for both equally, so that the person that's listening to your testimony is like, oh yeah, they were asked these questions and they were asked these questions, and you answered all of them because you know all the things that you testified to, right? And so don't argue, try and keep your body language open and engaging with both sides, both prosecution and defense. Again, talking to a meeting with the attorney, sometimes it may be helpful to sit in on relevant evidence or relevant testimony, not typically. That'll be a conversation you have with your prosecutor. Determine what kind of case it is. It may be different if it's civil or criminal. Alyssa, I know, testified on a few civil cases, and then ultimately just said, I'm not doing that anymore. you know, so you make those decisions, and that may be a circumstance where you decide you do want to charge or you don't want to charge, but take that as a case by case. Learn the names of the attorneys and the judges so that if need be, you know who is who instead of, you know, that guy or what she said, or, you know, learn the names, determine the stage of litigation it's at. You're gonna know if it's at trial. Right? But there may be times where you're testifying at a pretrial. So just have an understanding of where it's at. And again, that comes down to just that conversation with the prosecutor, so that you know, hey, I need you for this. This is what we're trying to accomplish. This is the information aspect that we're trying to address. And I need you to testify for that. Make sure you don't have a conflict. And if you do, like Danette brought up, make sure you're having that conversation with your victim. They are number one. That victim and their ability to move forward is more important than our case. That is hard for especially us as prosecutors, because our case is number one, But as advocates, your victim is number one, and you need to hold what's best for them at a very high level. So some issues that are raised by defense attorney. Checking time here. Are you getting paid for your testimony today? This is one reason why not getting paid is a huge benefit. Because if you aren't getting paid, then it looks like you're just being paid for your lip service to say what we want you to say. If you're not getting paid, you can say, no, I'm not getting paid. They ask if I testify to my knowledge base, and so that's why I'm here, to share what I know. That has great power. Rochelle.
If you're off, you are getting paid because you're on work time, technically, like your agency's allowing you to testify. How do you say yes or no?
I would just say, I'm not getting paid for my testimony. I'm here during work hours, and so I'm being paid like I would if I was at my desk, but I'm not being paid for my testimony.
I know in Salt Lake City and West Valley, maybe the court pays the witnesses as well. Is that something that happens with expert witnesses too? We get 18, our victims get 18.50.
Yep. And if you get that, most of the time, you'll just sign that over to your office because they're paying you. And so a defense attorney might try and be tricky and say, well, you know, there's a witness fee of $18.50, so you're going to get that on top of your wage. And then you'll say, well, no, actually, when that check comes through, that'll just be signed over to my office because I'm just doing this on work time. I'm not being paid for my testimony. Was there a hand back? No, we're good. Okay. What if you don't have a higher degree? What if you are started out as a volunteer advocate, you don't have an associate's or bachelor's or any other degree for that matter? Think about, as an expert witness, how long have you been doing this? Approximately how many victims have you worked with? In what different settings have you worked? Have you worked in the courtroom setting? Have you worked in the shelter setting? Have you worked in crisis response, on scene setting? Think about that, because you know, I went to law school and we learned all about the laws and how to find them. But as far as what you actually do in the courtroom, we took a trial ad course, which I did that. But learning to be an attorney is a whole different set of skills than what you can learn in school. And so if I'm a defense attorney and I ask you and say, you know, so do you even have formal education for what you're doing? And you can say, I have been trained since, you know, I started this job in 19 or 2000 or whatever your date is. I've responded to 2000 crisis calls. I've worked on court cases. I've worked in the shelter setting. I mean, you're gonna have all that background. And one thing that I would be sure to include, or that would have power to include, is to say, working with real people is always more beneficial than words on a page. You know, working with real people in real cases is more powerful than having words on the page, in my opinion. And you can just say that, in my opinion. That's, you know. No published research. You're doing research all the time and it's in here. It's not published. Your focus is on helping the people. It's not on being published. You're not pursuing academia. You're pursuing helping people, being that support to them. So just think about some of these questions and then formulate, you know, a good response to it, and talk to others about, you know, even prosecutors about, if this comes up and I answer like this, do you see a problem with that? Because of course they'll have the courtroom perspective where you don't, that's not your niche, hasn't been to this point. But there's really nothing. You have everything you need to be an expert witness. You've met that threshold. You have knowledge beyond what the typical person has. And so they're gonna ask these questions to try and make you look bad. Don't hang your head. Don't be flustered. Just tell the truth. No, I don't have higher education. I've been working in this job since such and such, and I've worked with this many people, and I'm learning as I go, and I'm seeing similar things across the board as far as the dynamics of working with survivors of domestic violence. So we've kind of talked about this already, but anything else, if you've ever testified as an expert, that you want to add? Okay, so we're gonna put it into practice, but I've given you some tools, okay? First of all, there's handouts. This is what we've prepared for the attorneys, for the prosecutors. And again, the vast majority of this, you don't need to know, but if this helps you feel confident that you belong in that seat, take a look at it, read through it. These are other courts, other cases, other decisions that have said, yeah, they're an expert. They belong there. We can hear from them. So we've made this basically as a tool for prosecutors to argue why they're experts. You're not going to be sitting on the stand arguing why you're an expert. Your prosecutor is going to be doing that if there is any opposition or argument. And when I say argument, I mean just an assertion of opinion, right? They're not actually going to be arguing. I've also got qualifying questions. So this is questions. Your prosecutor may or may not follow this. They certainly don't have to follow this. And there's lots of questions on here that wouldn't need to be asked at a trial, depending on what the facts of the case are. But we're going to use this today, and I wanted to provide it to you so that you could read through it and think of, I don't know about that question. I wouldn't have thought of that. How would I answer that? So you can basically be prepared and like, oh, I've heard that question before, or I've thought about that before, and here's how I would answer it. Just to allow you to practice in your mind what your responses might be. And then I've also got for you, are we frozen?
Oh, sorry.
Oh, that's okay. A handout of tips. So a handout of tips to prepare your expert witness for cross-examination. So this is helpful to look through, and the site to it is on the bottom. And of course, this is dealing with experts with, you know, technical facts as much as we'd be testing on behavioral facts and information, but the principles in it in helping you to prepare with a defense attorney may be beneficial. So I just wanted to include that for you as well. Okay, so we are at 2:33. Rochelle, do you want to explain how we're going to do this? And then we'll come back after. Oops.
Okay, so our online folks, we're going to break you into 8 breakout rooms. And for our in-person, we're just going to do 2 breakout rooms. But each session will have a prosecutor and a moderator, and then you as the advocates. And instead of forcing one advocate to be the one that testifies, we'll look for volunteers. If we have no volunteers, that's where the moderator will help us select a volunteer. And you can rotate through the questions. So you can let the prosecutor ask a couple questions to one volunteer and then rotate in someone else. But essentially, we just want everyone to have the opportunity to answer some of the questions. I personally like, if I like people saying, hey, that sounded great, but you know what might actually sound better, and kind of do this build on it. So yeah. Please, this is a workshop. So if somebody else offers up a suggestion, like just kind of take it and ask for it. If you do not want feedback, if you said, I'm the only one that's volunteering, nobody else has stepped up, like do not offer me any feedback, that's fine too.
But I would discourage you from doing that, because this is the safe place, right? So if you come up with an answer and you think it's a good answer, and no doubt it probably will be a good answer, but if there's a better answer that will help you feel more prepared and more confident in court, like hopefully we'd all be open to hearing that, you know, and learning from it.
And you just know, of course, after somebody hears an answer, you can always come up with something better, right? Like that's just nature of it. So,
yeah,
but I have taken those critiques and been able to use them later. So it is helpful. So we hope that you just are open to this experiment, that you participate in this, and we'll just kind of see how it goes. We've never done it before. And so we hope that workshopping it will be helpful. So I think, do you have any further instructions?
Just to encourage you to engage with it, whether or not at this point you're sitting there going, well, that's fine, but I'm never going to be an expert. You're never getting me in that seat. Still engage with it and explore it, because your insights and thoughts might be beneficial for someone else, and you never know. You might actually have to get in that seat in the role of your job for whatever reason. So just take advantage of the safe place to do it and to kind of think through, you know, and burn those new neural pathways as far as, you know, how you can express information in a meaningful way.
Okay, so we are gonna go ahead, and Maddie will break everyone into their breakout rooms. Go ahead and click join in your room, and you'll be taken to your room. In here, we're just going to separate you right down the aisle. And this side over here will be
ask we have, let's see, we're at 3:17, we're gonna wrap up at 3:30. So are there any of our prosecutors from the online groups that wanted to contribute a theme or something or a problem that they want to reemphasize with others that weren't in your group?
You want us to just chime in, Marlise?
Tell us your name.
Oh, Rhiannon.
Hi, Rhiannon.
I would say everyone did great. I think that it's an intimidating situation, and I think try to remember that you know your stuff and have some confidence. And if you have any doubts about what's going on or what they need, or if you don't know, say you don't know. And I think confidence more than anything. You guys are a really capable, intelligent group that does really good work for people, and you know what it's like, and don't let anybody make you feel like you don't know what you're doing.
Great. Anyone else?
Yeah, one thing, if the defense tries to say you did something wrong, don't be afraid to stop and say, wait, no, that's not what I said.
So this is Doug Smith, he's a prosecutor. Okay, great, and that was good input, Doug, to have that conversation and make sure that they clarify. And it's not just the prosecutor, it's also defense. If defense asks you a question and you don't understand, or they've asked compound questions, meaning multiple questions, just say, I don't understand, or which question did you want me to answer? That always kind of sets people back on their heels, like, slow down, you know, which one do you want me to answer? So good input. Any other from our outer ranks?
One thought from me, Marlise. We had a question about, like, would a prosecutor ever want to be like super nitpicky or try to twist your words on the stand? And my answer is absolutely never. I want you to to look as good as possible. You, especially looking at our fact scenario, like, you are the person that's going to win this case for us in the end, right? So I want you to be as credible and expert-like as you possibly can be. Like, we'll leave the nitpicking stuff for defense counsel. They'll try to twist your words, but I never will. And my only other thought is, like, when I ask a question, answer my question, but don't hesitate to give more good information if you've got it. Like, especially if we've communicated beforehand and you know what I really want you to say, go ahead and say it. And if we get an objection from defense counsel, we'll deal with it then, and I'll ask you another question and we'll get more out. But you're the person that's the star of the show, so you're the one that gets to talk, and the jury really does care what you have to say. So I'm just there as the, like, to turn on the faucet and let it come out.
Josh?
I had a quick comment following Josh, who made great points, reminded me that sometimes I don't always ask the best questions. So if you have a prosecutor who asks a question that you don't understand, don't hesitate to ask a prosecutor to rephrase it. Don't feel like you have to fish for an answer, because I may not always be the best at making questions either.
And so don't hesitate to be a leader with them as well, and help them. Okay, I think, who else did we have? Clint, are you still on? Some might have had other things they had to get to. Okay, was that helpful? Would you say, was that helpful? Did that help some of you who thought, no, I wouldn't do it, actually think maybe I would do it, you know, get a little closer to maybe I would do it? It's like anything else. The more you do it, the more comfortable you'll get with it. And I would really, really encourage you to just really try to do it. Maybe take a simple, and I'll throw an email out on our forum for all the prosecutors saying, look, we've done this training, and certainly not all advocates were there, But if you have a DV case coming up, give your advocates a chance to testify in a DV case that maybe it isn't all pivotal on your testimony, right? I just did a jury trial about a month ago for a small agency that was just overstacked, and I didn't need an expert. That's not where it lay. But if I had an advocate who wanted to have that experience, I would have put her on the stand and I would have asked her the questions, and it wouldn't have hurt anything. And there's no pressure on that advocate in that situation. So they feel like, okay, I can try my feet on this and go forward. Alex.
So a couple questions. One, is there a way that prosecutors are willing to work with victim advocates to help them gain their confidence in testifying? Getting more times than I can count. And I could feel pretty confident, but I also get nervous. And like, I probably spend more time in court and I believe in front of them. Under the victim's representative more than most people. So what are ways, like if your prosecution counsel, how are you going to help this team really get ready to post your next?
So well, like what I just said, you need a chance to get your feet wet in an environment that is as least stressful as possible. I mean, the bottom line is it's gotta be in the courtroom and you gotta be on the witness stand. But if you're in the courtroom and on the witness stand for the first time in a case where you feel like unless you can get the jury to understand the dynamics, maybe we'll lose the case, that puts a lot more stress on you, right? Than if you're just there as a general educator of the jury. And so encouraging our prosecutors on our forum that we're in contact with, and we do all the time, but now we can go back and say, look, we've just done a big training with however many 107 advocates that were part of this training that observed, if not participated in it, have a conversation with your advocates, community-based and system-based, and try and get them comfortable in the courtroom. One thing I would do is also prepare you in the way I would prepare a witness. Our victims have never testified in court. So we take them into the courtroom and we let them sit in the chair and feel what it feels like and to see the courtroom in front of them. Take those moments to prepare yourself in that same way. Michelle.
Dana had her hand raised, so I just wanted to check.
Dana.
Dana.
I
just wanted to just make a comment that even though when you're testifying, like you feel like the case hinges on your testimony, you're not the only person testifying. You're not the only information that is going to be given to a judge and jury. So if you can kind of separate that thought out of your mind, that can really help you just kind of focus on what you're there to do, answer the questions that you need to answer, and then just kind of move on, because the case isn't necessarily going to hinge on your testimony alone.
Right. Good clarification, Dana. Thank you. We do things in our minds that add to our own stress. And that's what I was trying to address. If we're going into a case and we feel like our role is somehow pivotal, it may or may not be, but there's so much other evidence and information going forward. So you're just one piece of it and you're the education piece of it. And just recognize that that's all you have to do. All you have to do is go up, sit in a chair, tell them what you know, and then walk away from the chair. And we can all, we can all do that. Okay, we shoot back to the wrap up slide. Just a couple things to keep in mind as we wrap up. Oh, I should ask Josh, because you were here in the room with me. Anything from your group that you wanted or that came up or question or highlight?
It was actually a lot of it that seemed to be related to how it was set up there.
Okay.
Getting experience. I just stepped up for a second, but I think one thing that was discussed is that if it wasn't mentioned again in the work mentioning, reach out to your prosecution offices and give them your name and tell them your circumstances, tell them your education experience, and tell them, please get me into justice court trial. Please get me into freelance. And then we can do that. Because I have had the experience where I have somebody on my list. I may have a high school kid that comes in that wants to do something. And I'm like, great. But to have somebody that is in our field that would be a resource like that, I absolutely want to make a connection for that. So that we can build that place where the big trial comes up and I have somebody that has done this multiple times already and is ready for the big league, so to say.
Okay, that's great. Do that, but don't just do that. Email me. Let me know. I will put you on the list as someone who is new to testifying and willing and wanting the experience and to gain confidence in testifying. so that I can circulate that when people ask and they will reach out to you, especially if it's in an area where they don't have an option to use their advocate and they need someone from somewhere else. So let me know and I will put you on this list. I'm not going to put you all on there just because you were here. But if you're willing to try, you know, if you're hesitant, I'll put whatever qualifier you want by your name. You know, Susan Smith is willing to try, has been through the introductory training, has never done it before. You know, she's available. Reach out to her. Okay, so partner with other agencies wherever you can. Again, we talked about that a little bit earlier as far as being in some rural parts, that's limited. But if you can, do partner with other agencies, because that's very helpful. Talk to your prosecutor. I just cannot stress that enough. Have that conversation with them so you both know what is needed, what's going to be addressed, and that it is a conversation and you're prepared. That's going to help with your confidence hugely. If you know already going in what the questions are going to be, essentially, not exactly specifically, but I'm going to tell my expert, we're going to talk about the cycle of violence, we're going to talk about counterintuitive behaviors, we're going to talk about, you know, B, C, and D, and then you know, okay, I know those things, I can talk about those things. Be prepared, know what you know. This goes to the logistics when you're in the seat. When you're sitting on the stand, try and avoid saying things like, I think, or I believe in your direct responses. If I ask you a question about the cycle of violence, you think, well, to the best of my recollection, or I think I recall that, blah, blah, blah. That just immediately waters down anything you're gonna say afterwards. If you are familiar with the cycle of violence, say, yes, I'm familiar with the cycle of violence. Tell me what you know about the cycle of violence. Then you tell me what you know about the cycle of violence. Know what you know. That I saw probably to the worst case scenario in a case that I had, it's been a few years ago now, quite a few years ago now, but where the defense attorney just walked the officer down the lane and off the cliff and he thanked him as he fell. Because he was, I believe, I think, I recall, he was so uncertain about everything that was so hard because I knew he knew. I knew he knew, but he was stressed or unconfident or something. And he knew after he fell off the cliff just how bad that was. And, you know, it was a learning moment and we all talked. But know what you know. You know, be confident. You know this stuff and heaven knows you know way better than any defense attorney. So if you're worried about them, that is not who you need to worry about. Just know what you know, tell them what you know. And the more you do it, the more comfortable you'll get. Talk to other advocates who have done this. So Alyssa Black, you can reach out to her with questions. She would be so happy to know that there are more people willing to give it a try, willing to testify. Rochelle, Danette Stanger. I'm trying to think of who else I have on my list as far as victim advocates. Wagner. Who?
Christiana.
Oh yeah, Christiana Wagstaff. Is she here? She's online.
Online.
Anyone else online ever testified? Is willing to throw your name in the chat? Jamie Pitt says, I also think it's helpful to go and watch other people testify. Absolutely. In trials and at hearings, if you have the chance to do that, absolutely. Okay. Well, I hope that was helpful. We need you. You guys are invaluable. You really are. And most, there's always the daft one here and there, but 90, 95% or more prosecutors, they know how invaluable you are. And we really need you more in the courtroom than we've used you in the past. And we will support you and help you. So reach out and let's, you know, make that a stronger partnership.
Great. Thank you so much, Marlies. Thank you. We'll make sure her information is in there. But we are going to take a quick 15-minute break. We're at the tail end of our day, and we want to make sure we get started on time when we get